Hi everyone, welcome to Let's Draw number 7, where I draw Tarzan fighting a gorilla. I was recording for 5 minutes and realized that my recorder turned itself off, so this is a reset for me. So, gotta go back through what I was just talking about. Again, the scene is more of an action-packed scene. It's Tarzan versus a gorilla. And I start off with tightening up with, as you can see, with the blue pencil. And the blue pencil, this is annoying that I have to, like, remember what I talked about. Sorry. So what I was talking about, like, sometimes I have to, like, with the last one, I don't think I had to go in and tighten up with blue pencil. I think there was, the image was large enough and there was enough information with my digital roughs that I didn't need to tighten it up. But this one definitely did need to go through and tighten up the, mostly like, definitely like the body, but like really the face and hands is like areas that I like to tighten up just because they're all mushy and in the roughs, because I work pretty small with roughs, a little bit smaller than how it would be printed in a book, and like, yeah, like at that size, like fingers and like faces just need a little bit more bone structure to them. More information for myself before I hop into the inks. And what I was talking about, each one of these Let's Draws, like I'm trying to focus in and I want to accomplish something. And for this one, I wanted to accomplish more creating an action scene and figuring out how to create, like to energize it and create motion within the scene. So starting off with my thumbnails, I focus in on composition and how the black and whites are gonna like reinforce that action motion scene. And as you can see, that background, like, so behind them, it's light rays. Actually, it's this way because this camera is gonna get flipped around, so like it's like this. So the light rays behind them, because they're crashing through a canopy, so the light rays are going this way, and then there's that log or tree that they're crashing through is a strong diagonal crashing through that in a different direction, and it creates like, you know, like this X. It disrupts that light flow, and also like it's just an aggressive element cutting through the entire piece at a diagonal, which diagonals create energy as opposed to, you know, horizontal and verticals. Now, so that's one way, and then you're gonna see when I get into the inks, I'm gonna be hatching in the background in one direction only, and I'm gonna stack that hatching, and I'm gonna stack that hatching. So it's all one direction. There's hatching and there's cross hatching. Cross hatching means that you're layering up the lines in different directions. Where hatching, you're going in just one direction and layering the line. So you're gonna see that later. I was talking about, and before I got cut off, I was talking about why artists work in blue pencil or color pencil in general. And I have a 11x17 all-in-one printer. So it prints on my sequential paper, that's 11x17, that's a standard paper size for working in comics, and it has a scanner for 11x17. So prints and scans, 11x17, that's all I care about. And it's a great tool for my process because I prefer to work digitally at first for my thumbnails and roughs, just because it allows me to quickly jump in and make adjustments on the fly, and allows me to really see how the black and whites are interacting with each other on a smaller scale. And so, and I usually have my thumbnails off to the side, just as a reference, just to make sure I constantly reinforce that black and white composition, so that carries through to the final piece. Unfortunately, I think for this one, I was kicking myself because I was like, oh, I forgot to print my a thumbnail of the, or like the rough for the black and white for reference for this one. So I was kind of just trying to, it's pretty straightforward, so I was just trying to make sure to follow the blue line underneath. But yeah, why do artists work in color? It's easy, it's to get rid of once you scan it in, and you can blow out the color pretty fast in Photoshop. Blue is just a popular color in general, just because I know I've talked about this in the past or previous recording, but blue pencil. So back in the day, part of the comic book process was once you finish your blue pencils, or not blue pencils, but once you finish your piece, you have blue pencil ink on top of blue pencil, and you put that, you take that to a copier, and you jack the contrast like all the way up, and the blue pencils they're using are non-photo blue, because the copiers back then had a hard time picking up certain colors. So one was a light blue, and when they use, so when they put that through the copier, it just got rid of all that blue pencil, and all that they were left with is a nice clean black and white image. Today we just use Photoshop. I have an action that I created in Photoshop that allows, it creates an adjustment layer. If you're using Photoshop, this is how I go about it. Create an adjustment layer, a color mix adjustment layer on top of the original image, and locate the blue, and mess with the levels and just blow out the blue. And that should get, that's gonna get rid of most of the blue, and you're just gonna be left with, and it's gonna turn some of that blue into like a gray tone. But from there you can bump the contrast and just blow it out, and you're just left with a really nice black and white image. So that's just a little method that I use. Okay, so hopping into the inks, using my brush, I'm going to be using my brush for the characters, and then when we want to hop into the background, it's going to be the nib. I have some tips for the nibs for some of you who are actually like want to use the nib. I'll get into that later, but once I get actually into the nib, but like just some quick things that you need to do when you get in a new nib, and also like taking care of it when ink gets a little too built up on it. Okay, so I had to make sure to, it's definitely an awkward angle for Tarzan, and I had to make sure to create his loincloth so we're not seeing, it's not too risque, not too much. You're gonna notice that I put a little like, when you think of like Amazonian tribe folks, they, and other tribal rainforest folks, like they have like armbands or leg bands with like leaves and feathers. I know I've seen it. You've probably seen it. And I tried doing that for the legs, but unfortunately, like when I work on these in chunks, so like I only have like 2 hours, like every day, or every weekday to work on these. And so I created, so I inked those like armbands around the or leg bands, and walked away, came back the next day, and I looked at them again. I'm like, oh, those are just like garter belts. So they were too, they did not look the way that I intended. So you're going to see me later eventually just edit them out. Mesmerizing. Just going real fast. Okay, a few things. Patreon. If you're a Patreon member, you get some rewards. And the link is in the top left corner on the other side of my little video right here. Go check it out. It just $1 a month. That's less than a cup of coffee, and it just helps me out a ton. One of the rewards that you're going to see is your name is going to be on this video for credits. And you're going to see some supporters already at the end of this. Now, looking at my show notes. So I pretty much went through like the focus for this is motion. So let's hop into like the nib, because I'm probably gonna start working on nibs in this piece pretty soon. All right, so nibs, when you get them, sorry, gotta reach. I don't know why I don't have this set up already. Well, you get them in a box. All my nibs are, whatever, can't find them. So usually when you buy the nib, they come in like a little container, and usually come in like, you get 10 per pack. And they're gonna come a lot newer and shinier than this, and they're gonna have, let me go ahead and pull this out. They're gonna have, it's gonna be all nice and shiny and new. Unfortunately, they're gonna have like a factory, like goop on it. You won't be able to really see it. It's just like a thin, like oil or whatever, just to make sure to preserve it, not let it rust when it's in storage until someone buys it. So you need to get rid of that before you can use it, because if you try using it beforehand, it's gonna be resistant to inks. And so there's two ways you can go about it. The first one that's most popular is you just need to get a lighter and just quickly like take that lighter and click it and just burn it on one side for real fast, and then flip it over and burn it on the other side, and that's it. You got, like, it melts off the factory goop. And after another way, sorry, and then another way to do it is Windex or any cleaner that has ammonia in it will get rid of that factory seal, whatever, oil. And that ammonia, like any, like, it's usually like window cleaners that have ammonia in it. Ink does not like ammonia at all, and so you might want to just keep some around for when these get, like, this one's like, you can see it's all cruddy and stuff. You can just drop it into like a little container of Windex and just leave it for a period of time, and it'll get rid of that, those inks, and make it a lot cleaner. And if there's a lot of buildup, you can take, I don't feel like getting it, you can take, and like sometimes it gets like really gross, at least for mine, maybe because I'm not taking care of them that well, but it can get really built up along the tip, and you just want to get an X-Acto blade And I like to get an X-Acto blade and just, just slowly go along the top of it and the bottom and just chip away at the inks until you see that silver come back. So that's another way. I should probably buy Windex. I haven't, because these all my inking all my nib tools really need it right now. All right, finally moved on to the gorilla. Hair, the nice thing with the brush, it really shines with hair. Just because with hair, you want to, when to make hair more natural, you want varying line, weight, and direction, and it just creates more of an organic inking when inking hair. And then also, because I'm using a semi-smooth surface, that means when the inks start becoming less on the brush before I need to like dip my brush back into the ink, it starts becoming the dry brush technique, where it picks up, it start the line starts breaking up, and starts and creates like kind of like a more of a fuzzy texture. I guess that's what you would call it. But yeah, the dry brush technique's really good for hair, and you can get that with more semi-smooth or vellum. I think it's vellum that has a rougher surface, and those are the surfaces that you want. You can't really do it so much with a cold press. No, hot press, Bristol board. I think the hot press is the one where it gets really super smooth. I do terrible on a hot press, honestly. My inks just, I cannot control the line at all. It's like night and day now. It's amazing, the difference between the two. And when I'm at conventions and people hand me Bristol board, or the sketch covers that are smooth, and it's just like, I don't like it as much. And of course, I'm working with my pocket brush somewhere around here. My pocket brush, which also I have a hard time controlling. So it is definitely, I think I'm going to be switching some of my less draws. Like, I like creating rules and I want to learn new techniques. This is a medium. I realize that I can do it. Because I'm working in comics, I cannot, editors do not like it, and probably readers don't like it either, when the style starts changing up. Like, they don't want, I can't play with style and the look of it on a comic. It needs to be consistent, so it's not jarring. It feels like a whole piece from beginning to end. So, but thankfully, I can play around more with this for these let's draws. So you can see with the fur, I'm sticking to that one direction. This is gonna get flipped. Okay, so it's this way. That one direction, just making sure all the hatching, creating that diagonal cut through that way. And that's why that log, it feels like a bigger impact, because all that motion, like from the lights, okay, the lights are coming this way, and my hatching is going to be coming this way, and then you have this log as, and the hatching and the lights are all like, it's mostly going to be black, or it's inked and gray, and then I'm going to have this big old image of a log coming in, and it just stops that, and it creates like that visual impact of them crashing into it. Okay, so moved over to the nib, using my Maru nib right here. All my materials are going to be on my blog post that So you can go to my website and find the blog post for this video, and like you can see, I tell you where to buy all these materials. All right, so hatching all in one direction, doing a first pass, and just kind of getting the gray tone down, and then you're going to start seeing me layer on top of that, like the leaves and the logs, and like it, you'll start seeing kind of more of a forest appearing as I continue layering in those areas. Oh no. I think I ran out of stuff that I was going to talk about. Still trying to figure out. Actually, no, I got word back from, I don't know if I mentioned this in the last video, but talking to a writer right now. We're trying to coordinate. We're trying to figure out how to work together on to create like a new IP for a comic. And I don't have any ideas. It's really going to be he's the one with some ideas, and I'm just going to be taking them and building off of them. he tried pitching it to publisher, but that publisher is not really looking for new IP at the moment. So in this industry, you make your own luck. We're gonna go. It seems like we're just gonna go ahead and just start creating the work and the pages, and it's just gonna start just to have it. And because once you have those pages and you can put in front of them a publisher and saying, this is what we want to create, you know, that's speaks volumes than when there's no work and you just kind of like just have the idea. And so yeah, that's it's like I said, it's creating your own luck, and it's raising the likelihood that of getting that comic picked up by a publisher. All right, so in the video, you can see I've been going through and just creating my little hatch, second layer of hatching with the leaves. It's just creating that depth. I didn't know, this was kind of like an interesting way going about it. Cause a lot of time, like I haven't, actually haven't done anything like this before. Usually I do a lot of cross hatching. Also trying to figure out how to make something how to make it look like light rays are coming through the canopy, how to make it look like there's motion through the canopy. This is all new stuff to me. So it's me playing around with the inks, which I tend to do you know, fairly well with. Like I kind of get like an idea and in my head and figure out the plan and then just stick with it, execute. Even if it's a mistake, they say just keep repeating the mistake, and then it just looks like it, you know, I did it on purpose. All right, so now that I'm getting to the bottom of the floor, there's more motion at the top where they're falling, and then you're gonna start seeing when I get to the bottom of the floor that I'm gonna start creating structure with more of the grass, the leaves, the flowers, just more of a, because I don't want that motion down there as much, and the hatch marks start going the other direction. So it just stops that motion flow visually. So why I like nibs. Each tool, when put in my hand, I react differently to it. Everyone is going to have that situation. That's why I play with your tools and see what benefit you get from that tool. For brushes, I get a lot cleaner lines freehand. I can get clean lines with the nib, but it's usually not freehand. It's more with a ruler. So yeah, I get cleaner lines with the brush. And I notice when I have the nib in my hand, because it allows me to like dig in and get that, and it has that resistance on the paper. Did I say nib? I meant nib. I might have just said brush. So the nibs allow me that that resistance, and it allows me to attack the page, and I can get like more dirty with it, like more sketchy. That's why I like using it more for the background, like I'm doing right now, because it kind of feels like I'm sketching more, and I can get more variation. It's a little bit harder to do that with the brush, and also you want your lines to be different. At least I want my lines to be different in quality, because I don't know what I was doing there. In quality, because the brush, lines with brush, are gonna pop off the page a lot better than like when contrasted with the nibs. There we go. Finally got through that. So you can see that layering in the background. Oh, now using the ruler just to make sure those light beams are kind of somewhat consistent coming through. Waiting for kind of something different to happen right now on the image. So, I guess I'm just going to talk about how my day's going, what I've been up to. So, I'm recording this on Saturday. You're going to see it Wednesday, and got my donuts, made sure I got my breakfast. Oh, I can do what I can talk about. I can talk about subscribing to my email. So you can please subscribe if you haven't already to my YouTube channel. So you can see these videos every Wednesday. And see. So yeah, I'm trying to release these every Wednesday. Reason why I chose Wednesday is because, if you don't know this, Wednesdays are also when comic book stores, they get the new issues, the floppies. That's when those get delivered to a comic book store. So if you want to see, if you go to the comic book store on Wednesday, you'll see boxes everywhere and they're trying to restock. excuse me. And also, you can subscribe to my email newsletter. And the email newsletter is just once a month. It's going to be the first Monday of the month. And it just gives you an overview of like what happened that month, what you might have missed or what's going on. Just a quick overview. And also for my for subscribers for email, I'm going to put a unique piece of art embedded into that email. That I won't share anywhere else, except for at a later date. I'm going to collect all of them. I'm collecting all these Let's Draw video images, and then the email images, and any other images I create on the side into a new art book. Hopefully I have enough pages by the end of this year to do that, because I do need a new art book at this point. Things have changed up and around with quality and style. I have some good pieces. You know, you might have seen my Black Canary and Zatanna like road trip image, or my Batgirl image, and those are actually, you know, they're decent. The reason why is because I had time to sit with them. and had the luxury of making sure that's a really nice image. Unfortunately, since I'm trying to move into comics, I won't have the luxury as much to sit with an image. Like, I'm just gonna have to like start cranking out the art, and excuse me again, I just have to start cranking out the art. So making sure that I can bring quality with speed is going to be the biggest challenge. And there's different ways to go about that. And honestly, like for my comic pages, like I'm debating going digital. I have some digital images up on my website in the gallery. In the gallery, you'll see the two images I just referenced, the Batgirl and the on a scooter, and Black Canary and Zatanna in a car. But you're also gonna see, you're gonna see a Crusader knight and guy on a bike. Those are digital. And I was able to take that, like I'm using Manga Studio, and I'm able to take that from thumbnail to the rough to the final inks, and it's digital, so I don't need to scan it. It's just like it, the process becomes streamlined because everything's in the computer. And yeah, speed. The only downside is I don't have the originals to sell, and that becomes I'm wondering if that is a big deal. Honestly, how I see it, I think it's more important to hit deadline at this point than making sure that there's originals to sell at a later date. Maybe when I have time, like I'll start, like in the future, if I'm lucky enough to actually like switch over to a full-time comic book artist. I mean, it's gonna take time before I can do that. Unfortunately, just because comic book artists, like, I would have to work super hard and be at a super high quality to reach my pay that I make right now as an animator. That's the biggest thing, honestly. And that's stopping me from like making a switch over. Just because other disciplines of art, I think, get paid way better than comic book artists. Wasn't always like that, and I feel like it was, that might have just happened because the industry took a dive once we left the 90s. The industry took a dive, and then people who work in comics, they do it for the love. But you know, artists need to eat, and I feel like I come across more bitter artists in the comic book industry. I also come across like some of the like happiest people, just because they're just so happy to be working in comics. You can make money off of it. You just have to be savvy about it, and you have to realize like I had professors talk about this where it's the brand, it's like, I'm the entrepreneur, and I'm a brand. Like, I'm at an animation studio, I'm just like a cog in the wheel, and like the company is the brand, and that's what's pushing our games. And but I kind of enjoy like stepping out and taking responsibility and saying, hey, this is me, this is my work. And letting people recognize me as an individual, and that's what comics are really nice about. Once you realize you're a brand, that means you need to start thinking more business savvy. To take control of all revenue streams, that are available. There's a lot, especially these days. Revenue streams, what are they? I actually went through a lot of YouTube. Well, I'm gonna stop. I'm gonna save that for next time. So that wraps up Let's Draw number 7. If you can like, share, and subscribe, awesome. Come back next week. I'm gonna make a note. I'm gonna talk about revenue streams that artists can take advantage of. And yeah, please click any of the videos down below to continue this if you wanna see how to take care of your brush, or you know, look at credit cards. These are my Patreon supporters. While this video is getting over, I was getting like warmed up. And yeah, that's the end. Thank you so much, and I'll see you all tomorrow.